Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu rasulullah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah again. So we're here for the Aqiqah gathering of the new entry to my family, Umar Jamil. So alhamdulillah, another Umar, Sheikh Umar, someone very dear to me from Yemen. One of the advices he gave me when I was studying, he said that try to revive those gatherings which have been neglected, which are from the Sunnah. And he mentioned one of those gatherings as being the gathering of Aqiqah. And he said a lot of Muslims do not celebrate this. Some people do, and what they do is they slaughter the animal and they distribute the meat abroad in a poor country and feed the poor, which is good. And it's sufficient for the actual Aqiqah. However, what he said was try to revive the practice of Aqiqah in your community so they understand that this is a Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So if you asked any individual, whether they're a child, whether they're middle-aged or elderly, about the concept of birthday, everybody knows what a birthday is, right? But if you ask many Muslims, Aqiqah, they say, what? In fact, when I phoned the butcher, it wasn't the actual main butcher guy in the actual place, however, it was one of the workers, and I said, I want to do an Aqiqah for my son. He said, what? I said, Aqiqah. He said, what? He said it three times. What three times? And then he said, let me speak to someone else. So he, working in a butcher shop, did not know what Aqiqah was. So either it's because of lack of knowledge or because people don't do it. He's not used to people asking for Aqiqah. If I'd said Qurbani or Udhiyah, he would have understood straight away because people do it. So it's very important that we revive the Sunnah. So even though we might do it abroad, it's still important to do it in our own locality. Also, for the benefit of the child, it's beneficial for the child as he comes into this world. We try to do as many sunnah actions and adab, so it's beneficial for the child himself. So he starts his life with the sunnah enacted upon him. And so, this is one of the reasons I made a kind of emphasized from our family that we should do an Aqiqah gathering. They're saying just do what other people do, especially when I had my twins. They said, just do what other people do, just send the meat abroad. I said, well, we can do that, but I want to also make a point of having a celebration in Glasgow itself. And now the concept of Aqiqah is quite interesting because it's not something which the Muslims introduced. This actually existed before Islam. So when the Arabs, when they had a child, they would slaughter an animal, they would feed people. But they had a practice, they would dip the head of the child in the blood of the animal. So the Prophet accepted the concept, but he abrogated the dipping of the head in the blood. And he said, instead of doing that, put saffron on the head instead. So this was something that was done before Islam. And in fact, the Salaf, the early generation, they were so adamant about this great sunnah that even if they didn't have enough money, as we know, a lot of Sahaba were poor, a lot of the first generations were not wealthy, but even if they could not find a sheep, they would slaughter anything, even like a chicken, for the sake of fulfilling the sunnah of Aqiqah. So there's a hadith which indicates the importance of doing the Aqiqah. كُلُّ غُلَامٍ رَحِينَةٌ بِعَقِيقَتِهِ تُذْبَحُ عَنْهُ يَوْمَ سَابِعِهِ وَيُحْلَقُ وَيُسَمَّى. That each child is rahina. Now this can be translated in different ways. A very simple understanding is that it's restricted. I'll come to this in a minute. Restricted by the Aqiqah. So if the Aqiqah is not done, he's restricted. And if once the Aqiqah is done, the restrictions are gone. Which is done obviously on his behalf. And it should be done, preferably, on the seventh day. And scholars say if you can't do it on the seventh day, then do it on the 14th day. If you can't do it on the 14th day, then the 21st day. If you can't do it on any of those days, any day will be sufficient. But that's just recommended. Also, his hair is shaved and he is given a name. So at the Aqiqah gathering, you announce to people this is what the name of the child is going to be. Now this meaning of restriction until the Aqiqah is done, scholars differed on what this meant. Some of them said this means that that child will not be able to intercede for its parents on the Day of Judgment until the Aqiqah has been fulfilled on his behalf. Others said that he will be restricted. In other words, he won't have as much tawfiq as other people. He might not be, might not have as much risk as other people because the Aqiqah was not done. So if the Aqiqah has not been done, right, for a child, then we should do that. Even if it's been a couple of years, they say the Aqiqah can be done up until the age of puberty. After the age of puberty, if it's still not done, the person himself or herself can choose to do the aqiqah on their behalf, on behalf of themselves. Now, there's a few recommended actions or mustahabbat relating to aqiqah. The first one I already said is preferable to do it on the 7th, 14th, 21st, and so on. Number two is that when the animal is slaughtered, you see, this is in the name of, it would be Umar ibn Amr, Umar the son of Amr. And it's also recommended, like I said, to shave the child's hair, and then you weigh the weight of the hair and the equivalent of value in silver, you give away in sadaqah and charity on behalf of the child. Scholar said you can give it and you can use gold because gold obviously has more worth. Then naming the child, Yusamma, the child is named. And naming the child is very important because, as we know, names have meanings. And the Prophet ﷺ, if he saw Sahaba had names which had bad meanings, he would change them. In fact, Umar al-Khattab, named one of his daughters Asiya, which means a female who sins. And the Prophet ﷺ changed it to Jamila. He said, that's not got a good meaning. Change it to a name that's got a good meaning. So it's very important because, when people have children, one of the things they bug me with is, give me a name. You say, look, pick any Prophet's name, any Sahabi's name. There's so many pious people. But a lot of people want a modern name, something that nobody's got. Something's a bit snazzy, something that's not boring. And they tend to forget the actual meaning of it. So Umar is not the first child to be called Umar, probably not the last. But look at who Umar was. It's sufficient that the Prophet said that, he said to Umar, he said, if Shaitan was, if Shaitan saw you in the street, he would cross the road. He also said, if there was anyone who would have been a prophet after me, it would have been Umar. So look at the person that the person is named after. And I ran it by one of my teachers, who's also called Umar, and he approved of the name Umar. So I said, okay, Bismillah, we'll go with Umar. And the Day of Judgment, it says, innakum tud'auna yawm al-qiyamati bi asma'ikum. That on the Day of Judgment, you will be called forward by your names. Wa asma'i aba'ikum, and the names of your fathers. Fa ahsinu asma'akum. So give yourselves good names. So it's important that we think when we name a child, what name we want to give them. Other rituals which happen before the aqiqah, the first thing, as the child is born, the first thing we should do is we should give adhan in the right ear, and we should give the iqama in the left ear. And also you do what's called tahniq, or for you guys, gurti, right, which is you find a pious person. The practice of the Sahaba was, if they had a child, they would take it to the Prophet ﷺ, and he would chew like a date or something, and he would just rub it in the palate of the child, so that the first thing that the child ate was from a pious person. So that is another practice, and obviously for males, circumcision, but that obviously comes a little bit later. And lastly, just to mention that obviously we're happy when we have a child, irrespective of the gender. It doesn't matter if it's a boy or a girl. And it's sufficient for us that when Fatima Zahra, which is what my daughter's called, my son's called Muhammad, when she was born, the Prophet ﷺ showed a lot of joy. Even though it was a fourth daughter, he showed a lot of joy, and he was extremely ecstatic. And he said to Sayyidina Khadija radiallahu anha that it's a blessed child. So he was extremely happy when that child was born. So it doesn't matter if it's female or male. The most important thing, obviously, is that the person grows up to be a pious, obedient person who's beneficial for them, their own family, their friends, and the community. وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ سَيِّدْنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلِي وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمْ تَسْلِيمٍ كَثِيرًا. الحمد لله رب العالمين.